Now we move to part three, that is 9/11 and the academia, breaking the truth taboo. And it's a pleasure to invite on the stage the next speaker, Piers Robinson. Piers received his doctorate from the University of Bristol in the UK. His main research focus is the study of propaganda, with particular emphasis on media reporting and propaganda operations during wars. Dr. Robinson is currently co-director of the Organization for Propaganda Studies and was previous professor, chair of politics, society, and political journalism at the University of Sheffield, also in the UK. He has published extensively in academic journals over the past 20 years, and his work has been cited in publications such as The Responsibility to Protect, published by the International Commission on Intervention and State Sovereignty. He has received numerous invitations to lecture, advise, and present briefings, including to the NATO Defence College in Rome, to senior UK military commanders and diplomats at the University of Oxford, and to the Military Academy in France. Dr. Robinson has given public presentations for some very good events like Stop the War Coalition and one I like very much, Media on Trial. He does the other way around. Mm-hmm. Piers, more than welcome.
So, as I say, this is about addressing the academy and the problems that we have within academia in terms of getting our heads around the issue of 9/11. And I thought the easiest way for me to do this, and the most productive way for me to do this, is to talk through three issue areas. And first of all, I want to talk generally about what we as academics know about propaganda, what we know about deception, and what we know about the media, and what we know about media failure. And part of the purpose of doing that is to perhaps give a little bit of a kind of intellectual underpinning to start to understand why all of the things that you've been hearing today, all of these fascinating talks and all of this detail, why this isn't known, why it's the case that these things can appear to happen and we don't hear about it in the media, we don't hear academics talking about it. So talking about propaganda and deception and media failure is a part of trying to give some kind of context for us all to understand why we seem to have got into such a tight corner in terms of properly getting to grips with 9/11. The second thing I'm going to do really is to run through, actually picking up really or repeating some of the points which have been made in earlier presentations. And it's about trying to contextualize 9/11 in terms of its geopolitical and geostrategic importance. It can be easy sometimes for people to think, perhaps for younger people to think, 9/11 is something which happened a long time ago, it's 18 years ago, etc. What does it matter today? But I'm going to talk through what we know, or what we should know as academics, about the importance of 9/11 and how it directly bears upon what we are seeing today and what we might be seeing in future years in situations with Iran, possibly Russia and China. And in the final section, I'm going to talk through really, and hopefully it should be fairly clear from what has already been said today, but I'll reiterate it in terms of an address to the academy, to fellow academics. The academic state of knowledge about 9/11, the gaps that we have, and why it's so important that academics should, at this very late stage, and academics are notoriously bad at sort of coming late to issues, that we really need to grapple with this issue now. And I suppose I should add a little qualification. When I talk about the academia, I do not want to do a disservice to a significant number of academics who have spoken about 9/11, some of whom have lost their jobs, Stephen Jones, for example, because of the early research. I am fully aware that there is a group of severely marginalized academics who have been doing excellent work in addition to all of the independent researchers over the years. Who I'm talking to, who I'm addressing, is at a mainstream academics, at 99%, the core body of academics, who still to this day don't really grapple with 9/11. So, first of all, to talk about propaganda, as an academic, I'm somebody who, historically, I've researched foreign policy and media. Since 2010, I've become more and more interested in the role of propaganda, not just about understanding how the media operates or how foreign policy formulation occurs in relationship to the media, but understanding how people are propagandized, how the media is used to propagandize people. And I've become increasingly interested, and essentially this is my research area now. This is why I have the Organization for Propaganda Studies. What is propaganda? Propaganda, I mean, when people think of propaganda, people frequently think of totalitarian states or historical war propaganda. Many people, certainly in Western liberal democracies, do not think that propaganda is something which is necessarily in their immediate environment. And I'll come to the reasons for that in a minute. But what is propaganda? What do I mean by propaganda? Propaganda is essentially a coordinated approach to influencing beliefs and conduct, shaping the way people act, shaping what they believe, and getting them to behave in particular ways. The critical thing with propaganda is it is not a consensual process. It is not about me trying to persuade you in a rational, objective, honest way to come to a particular agreement with me on an issue. It's about me attempting to manipulate you through deception, possibly coercion, possibly incentivization, in order to get you to do something or think something which is essentially against your will. So propaganda is inherently manipulative. It's about power and control. Violates rational or free will. Deception, when we think of propaganda, we often think of deception, lies, etc. But propaganda involves far more than simply communicating distorted or deceptive information. It can also involve the communication of threats, the communication of incentives, and it can also involve propaganda of the deed, doing things in the real world in order to shape people's perceptions. And if we accept 9/11 is a false flag, for example, it's an act of propaganda. It's a psychological operation. It's about mobilizing people to think in a particular way. It is a form of propaganda. Now, one of the problems that we have in the West grappling with this, and actually it doesn't just apply to many people within the establishment and many people within academia, also applies to many people in the public, perhaps less so, but one of the problems we generally have in the West is that we don't think that we live in a propagandized world. We don't think that we're subject to propaganda. Historically, it's very, very clear. Propaganda formulated or as a strategy of control was refined as a technique in the early part of the 20th century. And in the early part of the 20th century, it was quite openly spoken about by academics, politicians, and even the public. Eddie Bernays, nephew of Sigmund Freud, is understood by many to be the founding father of contemporary propaganda. And here's a quote from him. He talks about the conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Propaganda was seen by elites as a key part of managing democracy, taking the risk out of democracy. And they were very open about it. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country. So this is all openly spoken about. Academics researched it and spoke about propaganda, certainly in the first part of the 20th century. But something happened, and as Eddie Bernays rather candidly admitted, I'm not quite sure of the date, but he said that, well, propaganda and all of our theorizing and developing techniques of propaganda got a bit of a bad name because of the way the Germans used it in the First World War. So Eddie Bernays said, well, we had to come up with a new term to describe these activities that we're engaged in. And so we found the words Council on Public Relations. And therein was born the term public relations, which we still use today. What we call PR today was historically called propaganda. And really what we see, and this is one of the problems that many people in the establishment and in academia have in terms of understanding how much manipulation there is that we have played a euphemism game, starting with using the term public relations, a sort of a softened way of trying to describe strategies of manipulation, And we developed, as Phil Taylor described, a euphemism industry. We have terms such as political marketing, psychological operations, strategic communication, perception management, all of these terms used to developed in order to essentially disguise the processes of manipulation that governments engage in and other powerful actors engage in democracy. It is no more and no less than a euphemism game. It's disguising what is really going on. Deception. Okay, I'm sort of moving slightly away from propaganda, although to the extent to which deception is often an integral part of propaganda, obviously there is overlap. But I want to talk now, if I'm making the point that sort of we live in a world where propaganda is practiced and used, even in liberal democracies, we just call it something else, I want to emphasize the point about deception, and then some of these points did come up in one of Barbara's later talks today. But the idea that deception is a political strategy, it is something which is real and it is tangible, and it is seen, especially in the realm of foreign politics, but also in domestic politics, but particularly in the realm of foreign policy, it's seen as a key part of pursuing strategic objectives. And the name there is Professor John Mearsheimer, a very eminent American international relations scholar, and he wrote a wonderfully honest book in 2010 called Why Leaders Lie. I think he was inspired somewhat by the experiences of Iraq and all of the questions over WMD, etc. But he wrote that, well, deception is a major part of politics. But the problem is that all of us political scientists and social scientists, we don't really talk about it very much. We don't want to go there. We don't want to engage in this rather difficult, controversial area of talking about politicians and deception. But it's a political strategy, and John Mearsheimer goes through many, many historical examples where deception has been used in international politics. He also makes a wonderfully counterintuitive point in his book. He argues that actually leaders of countries tend to lie less to each other than they do to their own publics, to their own populations. The reason for that, states have intelligence services that can work out what's going on, etc. So he argues that leaders are actually much, much more likely to lie to their own populations in order to, for example, mobilize a population to go to war. Got much more deception going on between leaders and populations than you do between leaders in the international system. And he's a realist at heart, and he argues that ultimately foreign policy elites are best placed to decide foreign policy. Publics are often an unuseful element in terms of the formulation of rational foreign policy and pursuing the national interest. So this is a real mindset. This is not a conspiracy. It's not just speculation. This is a mindset, certainly amongst many people in the foreign policy community and the intelligence services and within the political establishment, that deception is necessary in order to get publics to support what needs to be done in the international system. Sometimes when you're sort of at formal settings or in military settings, you will hear people talking honestly about the need to, well, hoodwink the public on that issue, etc., engage in a bit of a propaganda over here in order to get the public to support what needs to be done. So, I mean, in terms of nuts and bolts of foreign policy formulation, deception is a strategy and it's used repeatedly. Mearsheimer also makes a point that liberal democracies will often deceive their own publics when the behavior of that country contravenes its claims to abiding by international law, abiding by high moral standards in the international system. So he identifies it as a particular problem for democracies. It's also worth keeping in mind that the notion of deception in politics is a kind of a deeper level ideological mindset of, you want to call it ruling elite, you can, or if you want to call it the establishment, I don't mind, it doesn't matter. But a belief, and it's essentially, it goes back to the notion of Plato's noble lie, the idea that in order to maintain order, in order to maintain structure in society, you need to engage in lies and deception. And there's a wonderful quote there from Irving Kristol, arch neoconservative, about truths for the intelligent and the rulers, and those truths are not the same as the truths for publics and poorer people and lower classes, etc. And it's a fallacy of modern democracy that these truths are all the same. It's essentially Plato's noble lie. And this is an ideological mindset, and you can see it in many of the people in the establishment. We've talked about the neocons today. That's a particular mentality. This idea of deception and the necessity of deception is a core belief, certainly amongst some people within the political establishment. Now, what this, of course, all helps us to do is to start to understand why we might be in a situation of not really knowing what has been going on for the last 20 years in relation to Western foreign policy and in relation to the triggering event of 9/11. We live in a world of propaganda, we live in a world of deception, and we live in a world in which political actors in positions of power believe in a necessity to deceive on various levels. The final problem, because of course, you know, one might put their hand up, and I do have some liberal academic colleagues who would put their hand up at this point and say, aha, yes, but we have the media. We have a free media in the West. Well, not according to what I would argue to be the most convincing research and scholarship, certainly in terms of political communication. We know full well that the big problem we have is that most of the mainstream corporate media do an extremely bad job of holding power to account in liberal democracies. Herman and Chomsky, a controversial figure for many people who talk about 9/11, but Herman and Chomsky, this was not their own model. They essentially pulled together the body of research and ideas which had been conducted for many, many years in order to understand why, in liberal democracies, the media doesn't do a very good job of speaking truth to power and holding governments to account. And they devised a propaganda model, and they ran through a whole series of interlocking factors. They call them filters, and they're listed there to explain why journalists don't really do what is expected of them, why they don't really challenge propaganda, why they don't challenge deception. Some of this is to do with concentration of ownership, commercial orientation of the media. Some of it's to do with ideological imperatives during the Cold War, for example. Anti-communism framed how journalists saw the world in the West and so on, and limited how they addressed or how they understood and reported on conflicts such as Vietnam. But the most important little factor in there, number three, reliance upon official sources. This is almost an iron law of political communication. We know this again and again, because the studies show it, that journalists defer to elite sources, official sources when constructing the news. Not all the time, but an awful lot of the time. And when it comes to foreign affairs, journalists are particularly prone to following the lead of the foreign policy establishment, especially in wartime, especially on those high foreign policy issues. And of course, in a world where journalists do rely heavily upon official sources, and in a world where many people in positions of power engage in deception and also pour tremendous resources into propaganda, if journalists are then going to those authority figures and so on and relaying what they're saying, then the media very rapidly becomes a conduit for propaganda and for deception. And really, number three, reliance upon official sources, is the most easy and ready way of understanding why the media doesn't tend to do its job in terms of holding power to account, especially on the most controversial of issues. None of that's to say that you don't have controversy in the media. You do, but the idea is that it's very bounded controversy, that the really serious issues don't get engaged with properly. So media failure, the role of propaganda, the role of deception in politics, all of these things, I think, create a backdrop for us to start to understand, both publics and also academics, to start to understand why it might be the case that we don't necessarily really know what's been going on for the last 20 years, and we might not really know what happened on 9/11. That perhaps the official narrative, as defined and articulated in the 9/11 Commission report, the story of Al-Qaeda terrorists carrying out this attack, just maybe might not be entirely accurate. The geopolitical importance of 9/11. I want to talk a little bit about this. And in a sense, and again, this is somewhat of an appeal to fellow academics, because we sort of know this now. It's not really controversial, although some people do have to be reminded about this when they're formulating research questions and so on. But we know we have a very clear understanding now that 9/11 was, putting it politely, used and exploited in order to initiate a series of regime change wars. We've seen Wesley Clark popping up several times. I think he regrets saying what he said these days. But Wesley Clark was very clear in 2006, and he talked about being in the Pentagon shortly after 9/11 and being told that there were plans to attack a number of countries within a certain period of time, countries listed there. Very, very clear, articulating very, very clearly that 9/11 was being used in order to start, initiate a series of major conflicts in the international system. Now, actually, for many years, I used to mention Wesley Clark's statement to fellow colleagues, and they used to say, oh, he's just talking off the top of his head. He's gone a bit crazy, hasn't he? And so on and so forth. But would the Chilcot report or the Iraq inquiry, this was the British inquiry into the invasion of Iraq. There was so much controversy in Britain following the invasion of Iraq over claims of weapons of mass destruction which weren't found, the kind of devastation caused in the country following the invasion, that there was a major inquiry in Britain. And this threw up, ultimately, after many years and a lot of pressuring of the government, a number of documents which essentially corroborate what Wesley Clark said. And I want to just run you through these, because it helps you give a sense of what we know in strict academic terms, you know, concrete documents you can refer to about what the 9/11 global war on terror has really been about. Now, we all, in a sense, know about deception and WMD. We know from the Chilcot report that the British government manipulated intelligence, that Tony Blair essentially engaged in a campaign of disinformation, of deception, in order to mobilize the British public to support war, essentially making the exaggerated claim that Iraq had an active, live WMD production going on. So Tony Blair's quote there, it's established beyond doubt. The newspapers, the media in Britain, following along, as the propaganda model would predict, repeated the government deception over Iraq, Britain 45 minutes from doom. Chilcot report confirmed that. I wrote some papers which investigated all of that aspect of things and confirmed it 10 years after it happened. And as my mum pointed out when I had the paper published, she said, Piers, I knew this 10 years ago that the British government deceived everybody on weapons of mass destruction. And I said, yes, but I've proven it now with my research paper. But the Chilcot report threw out some fascinating documents. This is a British embassy cable from about 5 days after 9/11, and the British diplomat is saying, this is a direct quote, is saying that the regime change hawks in Washington are arguing that a coalition put together to fight a war on terror, to fight Al-Qaeda, we can use it to do other things in the international system. We can use it to clear up other problems. British embassy cable. This is a document, this is a memo from Tony Blair, or excerpt of a memo from Tony Blair to George Bush, talking about the plans for Iraq. There were immediate plans to invade Iraq after 9/11, which were shelved for a period of time because they decided to go for Afghanistan instead. But this gives you a sense of the kind of level of planning that was going on way, way before the invasion of Iraq and immediately after 9/11. And so Tony Blair is talking, and it's worth, as Britain is signed up to the International Criminal Court, Tony Blair is doing no more and no less than planning a completely illegal invasion of a country. He's talking about, let's arm opposition groups, mount covert operations. When we get some rebellions, then we'll go in and use force, and so on. This is a plan to overthrow Iraq, which was put on hold whilst they dealt with Afghanistan. This is from a document called Phases 1 and 2 of the War on Terror, again from Tony Blair to George Bush. And Tony Blair, in this section, after listing seven countries, most of which are identical to the seven countries that Wesley Clark identified, Syria and Iran are mentioned. And here you can see Tony Blair saying, well, if our objective is to topple Saddam, get rid of him, it's far easier to do that strategically with Syria and Iran coming on board or acquiescing than trying to hit all three countries at once. So clearly the conversation going on between Bush and Blair was, you know, should we do them all at once? Are we going to try and squeeze these countries into the 5 years? Or do we try and sort of spread it out somewhat? Very powerful confirmation and corroboration of what Wesley Clark said in 2006. I'd add to this, in addition to Wesley Clark, is I think it's Colonel Wilkerson has recently done a radio interview on alternative media. Colonel Wilkerson was Colin Powell's chief of staff, and he said exactly the same thing. He said, yep, I knew about the plans. He also added that he knew about these plans prior to 9/11. Wesley Clark said he was shown these plans after 9/11. Wilkerson has now said publicly that he saw the plans before 9/11 for attacking multiple countries. And here's my point. You have a series of regime change wars being used, being fought off the back of 9/11. And from an academic point of view, this is really beyond dispute now. You cannot challenge it. The evidence is there, the documents there, the testimony is there. And this does lead through, and that slide showing Iran and Syria being discussed, that does lead us right through to the situation we're involved in today in conflicts in the Middle East. The conflicts in Syria, conflict in North Africa with Libya, Yemen, etc., all of these can be traced directly, stroke indirectly, back to 9/11 and those plans which were initiated back then, with variations along the way and with various disconnects, but still this is part of a regime change agenda which has been pushed for 20 years. And in Syria, for all the deception that there was in the case of Iraq, okay, and all the awareness that there should have been amongst populations, amongst politicians, amongst the media, that there was, if there was deception in Iraq, maybe there's deception in Syria. Well, there's been a huge deception in Syria, which has basically been bought hook, line, and sinker by large sections of the West. The Syria conflict and the deception involved in that, and we're looking at this closely with a working group I'm involved in, it's been a multi-layered propaganda campaign. It's involved formal information or psyops. It's involved the co-optation of think tanks, civil society groups, NGOs. Human Rights Watch is one, which is we're almost absolutely sure has been co-opted in terms of pushing and promoting propaganda in relation to the war in Syria. One of those countries on the list of countries to be taken out. The narrative, as you're all probably aware, because this is a live conflict and it's carrying on as we speak, the narrative emphasizes that you have a brutal, oppressive, repressive Assad government using chemical weapons against a pure as the driven snow democratic revolution. That's the kind of propaganda representation of what's going on, or distortion of what's going on. The truth that has been systematically obscured in a way that is arguably much more severe than the truth that was obscured in the case of Iraq is that the West and its Gulf State allies, Operation Timber Sycamore, have been arming and supporting extremist groups, some of them al-Qaeda-linked groups, in the war in Syria. A complete sort of upside-down or perversion of the war on terror narrative, in a sense, if this is all about dealing with al-Qaeda, well, we've actually been supporting extremist groups. This is now becoming much more known publicly. This is what's been occurring. But that's the truth that the propaganda has obscured in the case of Syria. Professor Sachs, again, us professors and academics always coming a little bit late into play, but a year ago, he said very clearly on American mainstream media, to the great shock of the news presenters, who almost cut him off, he said that, look, the war in Syria is our fault. There are 500,000 people dead in this conflict. We have done it. We have fought a covert and illegal war supporting extremist groups, and whatever democratic revolution there might have been, and it's very unclear the scale of that, certainly now, back in 2011, most of this war, most of the last 7 years of the destruction of that country have been fueled by us and our allies, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Turkey, in an extremely bloody and extremely violent and extremely immoral war in that country. Professor Sachs speaking a little bit of truth to power quite late in the day. But this takes us back to 9/11. 9/11 is a triggering event to where we are now. We have conflicts in Afghanistan, which continue to this day. Conflict in Iraq is continuing to this day. Conflict in Libya is continuing to this day. Syria, ongoing. Yemen. These can all be traced back to 9/11 as a trigger event. This is why 9/11 is so important and why it's so important to get to the bottom of exactly who was behind 9/11, because it has shaped the international system and it has underpinned what is increasingly being described, I think, as essentially a series of regime change wars and essentially imperial wars pushed and driven by the West. And it's so important because it's ongoing, it's emerging. We have Venezuela, we have Iran in the crosshairs, perhaps not with Bolton having been fired. But we also see the kind of ratcheting up of the propaganda in relation to Russia and China at this point in time. This is a war that we're involved in. It's a war that was triggered by 9/11. So it's essential we get to the bottom of 9/11. It's essential that we study that in order to understand why we are where we are today. And if it's the case that our worst fears are realized about 9/11, then we need to be very, very aware of the propaganda and the deception and how that might be employed again in order to take us into what would undoubtedly be a more catastrophic conflict or engagement in Iran and a apocalyptic conflict potentially with Russia and China. This is the road that we might be going down. So this is why 9/11 is so important. State of knowledge amongst my colleagues in mainstream academia. Mainstream academia, even critical academics, have accepted without question the 9/11 Commission official narrative on 9/11, almost across the board. Even the most critical of academics, such as Noam Chomsky, have maybe pushed the argument that 9/11 has been exploited, but they will never go any further than that. The idea that 9/11 in its entirety can be explained by a small group of hijackers flying planes into buildings, etc., has been accepted. And you see it again and again throughout all of the social science literature. Accepting the official narrative, and yet when you go back and you review the scholarship, okay, around that period, there was never any formal evaluation of hypotheses and counter-hypotheses in order to understand what might have happened on 9/11. The official narrative was simply accepted. Okay, no academics doing their job, in a sense, of saying, well, what has really happened here? Let's consider the possibilities. Is it a possibility that other state actors were involved in 9/11? Is there a possibility that there are elements within America who were involved in 9/11? Those things were never looked at. The official line was accepted without due diligence, in a sense, on the part of the vast bulk of academics. This is now untenable, and I'll repeat this in a few seconds as I move towards the end of the presentation. The state of knowledge, where we are now with this academic belief in the 9/11 Commission report and the official narrative, we're in a situation now where, certainly with the Hulsey report, but in addition, all of the other incredible scholarship and independent research which has gone on, we know for a fact that the WTC7 explanation has now been fundamentally challenged by what Hulsey has put forward, and you've seen a lot of presentations on that today. So there's clearly a gaping hole in the official narrative which academics have come to believe. Another very concrete thing which I often throw out to colleagues is insider trading and foreknowledge. The 9/11 Commission dismissed any possibility of trading foreknowledge in 9/11 attacks, put options, etc. Three economics papers published sometime after 9/11, the academics were pretty confident that there was almost definitely insider trader going on, and they reckon they'd proven it. Huge inconsistency between a 9/11 Commission claim, no insider trading, and what a few economists, looking strictly at the question, not who did 9/11, but on the question of foreknowledge, is fundamentally contradicted. Those are things which academics could and should not be able to ignore anymore. Hulsey's report, the insider trading issues. And third, and critically, and what I've been talking about in terms of recognizing the fact that we are in a global regime change war, which our countries and our governments are pushing at the cost of huge loss of life. Well over 1 million people have died in these conflicts. There's no doubt about that. No dispute over the numbers. 9/11 Commission, again, the narrative is simple. Al-Qaeda did it. There is no engagement with what we know now as academics, that they were planning regime change wars. And if 9/11 was a trigger for regime change wars, the next logical question that's begged is that, was there awareness that it was going to happen? Did they let it happen, as some people have suggested, or were other allies involved in helping instigate the event? Or was our own government, or elements within our own government, involved in enabling this event? These are things from a strictly logical, sort of social scientific point of view, inescapable at this point in time. And I think the academy, as I'll say in a second, the academy simply cannot get away with ignoring this any longer unless it's going to completely make itself redundant in terms of what it's supposed to be doing. So conclusions, just to wrap up. Propaganda and deception are ubiquitous in contemporary democracies. That's one of the things that people need to wake up to. Many of you here probably know this, but as I said at the start, you know, us academics tend to be slow catching up with a lot of people in society. But deception, propaganda, ubiquitous in democracies. We do live in societies where there's a very significant degree of manipulation and deception occurring. It's documented throughout history, and obviously with 9/11, we're looking at potentially a huge deception which has occurred. We have glaring inconsistencies, WTC7, insider trading, regime change wars, which are simply incompatible with the simple narrative which has framed academic debate and discussion on 9/11 for the last 20 years. The academy has persisted, and I think David Ray Griffin made a similar point many years back, that academia has persisted on the basis of a belief, not a tested, evaluated theory which has been robustly explored, etc., and demonstrated, but based upon a belief, much like a religious belief, in the official narrative on 9/11. That's obviously totally untenable for academics. Needs to be engaged with, and really to reiterate the point, because for all of us who are sort of involved, particularly in the ongoing conflicts and what might happen next in relation to Iran, for example, if we're in a situation where Western governments have been able to engage in this kind of deception and manipulation, if our worst fears are ultimately realized about 9/11, then it's absolutely essential that we, academics, publics, get control of our governments through whatever means necessary in order to stop even worse things happening. And it's not even something which is a secret. It's openly talked about. Bolton has been openly talking about attacking Iran. Some of the people that we have to engage with in Britain are openly talking about confronting Russia, about confronting China. And we're obviously in an extremely perilous situation. If 9/11 is what many of us fear it is, we're in a situation where we really have lost control of our governments, and unless we regain that, then the future potentially is extremely bleak for all of us. So, fellow academics need to engage with this issue now, and I think the evidence is there and cannot be ignored anymore at this point in time. Thank you.